You are born with gaps in your skull. It sounds strange, but there's a very logical reason for it. These gaps allow the skull to stay flexible during birth and give space for the brain to grow during early development. We call them fontanelles, and this is what we call the developing skull. As the child grows, those gaps slowly close and the skull begins to form joints. Most of these joints become completely stiff, called sutures. Others become a movable joint that allows the jaw to move freely. In this video, we will first look at the developing skull, go through the fontanelles and highlight the differences between a newborn and an adult skull. Then I made it very logical to understand the joints of an adult skull, and that is by dividing them into two types. The immovable joints, or synarthroses, including sutures, synchondroses and gomphoses, and one movable joint, the temporomandibular joint. We will cover each of these and put in a few clinical notes along the way to make it interesting. Hey everyone, my name is Time. I'm a medical doctor and I make animated medical lectures to make different topics in medicine visually easier to understand. If you would like a PDF version or a quiz of this presentation, you can find it on my website, along with organized video lectures to help with your studies. Alright, let's get started. So let's start with the developing skull. And let's start by adding a newborn skull and an adult skull. The newborn skull on the left represents about 0 to 1 month old, and the adult skull around 25 years old. What happens is, at birth, the bones of the skull are not fully fused. Instead, they're connected by soft connective tissue, forming what we call fontanelles. And I will touch upon that in more details in a minute, but these allow for flexibility during birth, and also leave space for the brain to grow rapidly in the first months of life. Over time, these close off and get replaced by solid bone. The timing varies slightly between individuals, but most fontanelles begin to close between the first few months and around 18 to 24 months of age. Now, look at the adult skull for a moment. You can see that all the fontanelles have closed and been replaced by sutures, which are immovable joints. These help stabilize the skull and fully protect the brain as growth slows down and eventually stops. So, somewhere along this timeline, from infancy through adolescence, these gaps gradually close and the bones of the skull begin to fuse. Some of these fusions happens early, while others, like the closure of the sphenoid-occipital synchondrosis at the base of the skull, don't happen until late adolescence or even early adulthood. Let's highlight the most important differences between a newborn skull and an adult skull now. First thing we can clearly see is the size of the viscerocranium, which is the facial part of the skull. In newborns, the viscerocranium is much smaller in proportion to the neurocranium. The face to cranium ratio in a newborn is about 1 to 8. As the child grows, the facial bones develop, especially with the eruption of teeth. By the time the skull reaches adult proportions, the ratio shifts to about 1 to 2.5. So, the facial bones in newborn are small and make up a much smaller part of the skull. Now, look at this. What's the first thing you notice? The mandible is small, and it's positioned in a way that allows forward movement during breastfeeding. The nasal cavity is also small, and so are the airways. In fact, neonates have a very narrow inferior meatus, which limits the airflow through the inferior nasal passage. And because of this, they have a higher nasal resistance, about 3.5 times higher in adults. This makes them more prone to airway obstruction and difficulty clearing the nasal congestion. Another thing is the paranasal sinuses. Paranasal sinuses are those holes in your skull that resonate the voice, help filter the air you breathe, and so on. Those are either underdeveloped or rudimentary at birth. So overall, the facial bones in newborn are underdeveloped. That's the first major differences between a newborn and adult skull. First out of three main differences. The second difference, proportion of the skull to the entire body. In newborn, the head makes up almost 1/4 of the total body length. That's why babies appear to have a much larger head. But in adults, the head is about 1/7 of the body's length, since the rest of the body continues to grow more significantly after birth. So, both the facial skeleton and the body grow to catch up with the size of the cranium. This is the second major difference between a newborn and adult skull. Now, the third and final one. Open sutures and fontanelles. What does that actually mean? In newborn skull, the bones are connected by wide sutures and fontanelles, which you can see here. These are flexible, fibrous areas that allow movement and growth. In the adult skull, the fontanelles eventually ossify, they turn into bone and close off. At the same time, the sutures gradually fuse and lock the skull into a rigid structure. So, what are fontanelles? Well, when a baby is born, their skull is not one solid piece of bone like an adult's. It's actually made up of several bones that are separated by soft, flexible areas, and those spots are what we call fontanelles. They're basically little gaps between the bones of the skull, and instead of being filled with bone, they're covered by a tough membrane made of connective tissue. You can feel them if you gently touch the top of the baby's head. Fontanelles are not dangerous by themselves, but if something goes wrong, they can tell you a lot. For example, a sunken fontanelle is usually a red flag for dehydration. A bulging fontanelle, especially if the baby isn't crying, might suggest increased intracranial pressure, which could be due to things like hydrocephalus, meningitis, and hemorrhage. A delayed closure of the anterior fontanelle might point towards conditions like congenital hyperthyroidism, rickets, and Down syndrome. On the flip side, if the fontanelle closes too early, especially if it involves the sutures as well, we think about craniosynostosis, which can restrict the brain growth and might require surgical intervention. So, fontanelles are not just developing features, they're important clinical windows into a baby's health. They're flexible at birth, and they give the brain space to grow rapidly at the first years of life. So, fontanelles are soft, membranous gaps where several bones meet. Sutures, however, are fibrous joints that connect two bones. They are still flexible in infants, but they're more narrow and more structured. And over time, they fuse and form solid bone connection called synostosis. Fontanelles eventually close and become part of these sutures, and so they're related, but they're not the same thing. For orientation, we can see the frontal bone, maxilla, mandible, zygomatic bone, temporal, occipital, and the parietal bone. Now, there are four main fontanelles. There's the anterior fontanelle. It's the one most people think of first, and it's a diamond-shaped, largest fontanelle that usually closes somewhere between 12 to 24 months of age. Then there's the posterior fontanelle, which is smaller and triangular and closes much earlier, typically 6 to 8 weeks after birth. Next, the sphenoid fontanelle, also called the anterolateral fontanelle. It's found at the junction of the frontal, parietal, temporal, and the sphenoid bones, and usually closes around 2 to 3 months of age. Then there is the mastoid fontanelle, or the posterolateral fontanelle, sitting between the parietal, temporal, and the occipital bones, and tends to close between 6 to 18 months. So those are the four main fontanelles, and each of them follow a pretty predictable closure timeline, which is useful in both development and in clinical exams. Apart from that, we can see the coronal suture, sphenosquamous suture, squamous suture, parietomastoid suture, and the lambdoid suture. Let's now turn the skull in this direction and look at the superior view. You will be able to see the top sagittal suture, and in the front is the frontal suture, also known as the metopic suture. It runs between the two halves of the frontal bone, as you can see here. In most people, it fuses by the age of 2 years, but interestingly, about 5 to 10% of the population have a persistent frontal suture into adulthood. That's called a sutura frontalis persistens, and it's usually just a normal variant, although in rare cases it can be mistaken for a skull fracture on imaging. Now, let's replace the skull with an adult skull. By this point, the sutures have completely ossified, forming rigid joints between the bones, and the fontanelles have closed. They have been replaced by these very same sutures and bones. From this view, we can see the coronal suture, which separates the frontal bone from the parietal bone. If we turn the skull to the lateral view, the coronal suture is even clearer. And just behind it, you'll spot the squamous suture, which connects the parietal bone to the temporal bone. And further back, there's the lambdoid suture, which runs between the parietal bone and the occipital bone. It looks almost like an upside-down V from the posterior view. And superiorly, we can see the sagittal suture running right down the midline connecting the two parietal bones. Notice how all of these sutures have that interlocking sawtooth appearance. That's what gives them strength and stability. Now, those are the sutures. They are immovable joints in the adult skull, what we call synarthroses. But don't forget, these sutures were once flexible gaps filled with fibrous connective tissue when we were born. So that brings up a good question. What other joints can we actually find in the adult skull? Besides sutures, we've got two more types of synarthroses in the skull, synchondroses and gomphoses. And we have one movable joint, the temporomandibular joint, or TMJ, which is a synovial joint. It is the only freely movable joint in the skull. Then we've got ligaments. Those aren't joints themselves, but they're important supporting structures that reinforces and stabilizes the joints around the skull. So let's start with synchondroses. Synchondroses are joints where bones are joined by hyaline cartilage. Look here, one bone, here's another bone, between them a hyaline cartilage that is connecting them. This is synchondroses. They are firm, immovable, and typically found at the base of the skull, especially during development. So, here we see the front side of the skull. Let's remove the skull cap and look at the skull from this perspective. We will see this. Can you tell the bones apart? The bone at the back is called occipital bone. Lateral to it, we have temporal bones. We got the parietal bones, sphenoid bone. At the front, the frontal bone. And we got the ethmoid, chilling in the middle here. Now, of the synchondroses we can identify in the skull, one is the sphenopetrosal synchondrosis. This one connects the sphenoid bone with the petrous part of the temporal bone. Then there's the petro-occipital synchondrosis, which links the petrous temporal with the occipital bone. Next we have the sphenoccipital synchondrosis, which is a major one. It connects the body of the sphenoid with the basilar part of the occipital bone. This one usually ossifies between the age of 18 and 25. Then there is the sphenoethmoidal synchondrosis that lies between the sphenoid and the ethmoidal bones and typically fuses a bit earlier, around the age of 10. Alright, next up, gomphoses. Gomphoses is a pretty unique joint because it's only found in one place, the connections between your teeth and your jaw bones. So here you see the tooth inserted into the socket of the alveolar process, that is a gomphosis joint. It consists of three parts, the root of the tooth, the alveolar socket in either the mandible or the maxilla, and the periodontal ligament, which acts as a connective tissue anchoring the two together. Even though this is a fibrous joint and mostly immobile, it allows a tiny bit of movement to act like a shock absorber during chewing. So those were the immovable joints of the skull, synarthroses, the sutures, synchondroses, and gomphoses. Now, let's move on to the one movable joint in the skull, the temporomandibular joint, or TMJ. Let's just rewind to the last video where we covered the different types of synovial joints. Remember we said that the synovial joints have a synovial cavity filled with synovial fluid, articular cartilage covering the surfaces, have an inner synovial membrane, and are surrounded by a capsule? We also said that synovial joints include accessory structures like ligaments, discs, and bursae. Well, the temporomandibular joint is also a synovial joint that contains these structures. But it's a little bit more special than that. The temporomandibular joint are bicondylar, hinge-type joint with gliding movements. What does that mean? Let's break it down. So, the temporomandibular joint is a connection between the condylar process of the mandible and the mandibular fossae of the temporal bone. The term bicondylar means that it's made up of two condylar processes, meaning that the left and right temporomandibular joints work together. They move simultaneously and they don't function independently. That coordination is what makes you able to move your jaw easily. Now, the temporomandibular joint is special. It has some special features. It has an articular cartilage that divides the synovial cavity into two synovial compartments, making it a complex joint. Now, this is a really nice diagram from Physiopedia. It shows the content of the temporomandibular joint beautifully. You can see here the articular disc that divides the joint into a superior synovial cavity and an inferior synovial cavity. Each compartment allows different types of movement. The lower compartment allows for hinge-like rotation, like opening and closing the mouth, while the upper compartment allows for sliding movement, like when you slide your jaw forward or side to side. Apart from this, there are several ligaments that support the movement of this joint, and therefore, they are considered apart from the temporomandibular joint. So here we have the articular capsule again. The main supporting ligament is the lateral temporomandibular ligament, which reinforces the joint capsule and limits the posterior displacement of the mandible. We also have the sphenomandibular ligament, which connects the spine of the sphenoid bone to the mandible and acts like a passive support, and the stylomandibular ligament, which runs from the styloid process to the angle of the mandible and help prevent excessive protrusion. So that's the temporomandibular joint, a unique dynamic joint that's responsible for stability, movement, and coordination of the jaw. It's the only synovial joint in the skull, and it's the only one you definitely want to know well in the clinical practice. Now, let's look at some accessory structures in the skull. These are ligaments that support the joints and surrounding bones. They're not joints themselves, but they stabilize and guide the movement of different parts of the head and neck, and they're highlighted here in blue. The first one is the stylohyoid ligament. It stretches from the styloid process of the temporal bone down to the lesser horn of the hyoid bone. This ligament helps suspend the hyoid in place and plays a role in swallowing by anchoring muscles like the stylohyoid and the digastric. Then there's the pterygospinous ligament. It runs between the spine of the sphenoid bone and the lateral pterygoid plate. Now, this ligament isn't always visible or even present in everyone, but in some people it can actually turn into bone. And when that happens, it can form a small bony bridge that creates what's called the pterygospinous foramen, or Civiniini's foramen. This region is right next to branches of the mandibular nerve, and if this ligament becomes bone, it can sometimes press on those nerves and lead to symptoms like facial pain, numbness, or even issues with taste, especially if the lingual nerve or other nearby branches are affected. Next, we have the sphenomandibular ligament, which you already saw earlier when we covered the temporomandibular joint. This ligament connects the spine of the sphenoid bone to the lingula of the mandible. It doesn't limit much motion, but it provides a passive support to the mandible, especially during movement like opening of the jaw. It's actually a remnant of the Meckel's cartilage from embryonic development. Lastly, the pterygomandibular rath, which is a fibrous seam rather than a traditional ligament. It goes from the pterygoid hamulus to the posterior part of the mandible, and it serves as an anchor point for the two important muscles, the buccinator and the superior pharyngeal constrictor, which makes it important for both chewing and swallowing. So those are the main accessory ligaments associated with the skull. Pretty fascinating how these tiny structures help stabilize the joints up here. But here's the thing, the skull doesn't move on its own. Its ability to nod, rotate, and tilt comes from how it's connected to the bones of the spine, especially the cervical vertebrae. That's where things start to get even more interesting. If you want to understand how the head moves, how posture is maintained, and how bones of the spine generally look, click on the next video, and I'll see you there. If you want a handmade PDF version of this lecture, take a quiz to test your knowledge, or access an organized list of all my videos, you can find everything on my website. Thanks for watching, see you in the next one.